I'd like to welcome to the stage my sweetheart and musical collaborator for this next piece. She's going to throw us some magic with this quartz crystal ball. He said it was okay. Thank you. I sang, I call these flute songs, and some of them are my original melodies, and some of them are inspired by other people's music. This last piece I'm going to play is called Peace and Power, and it's inspired by a wonderful Native American Oneida Iroquois singer named Joanne Shenandoah. This is Peace and Power.
James Marienthal, thank you so much for filling this space with that amazing, amazing art. Thank you so much. Amazing. All righty. Cheers. And remember, he does have his CDs out there. And what we want to do right now, yeah, you can go get that, is we want to bring up Mr. Deashaid. Where'd he go? Is he outside? Is he in here? There he is. I shouldn't say we. Dea had this amazing idea when we were brainstorming for elements of tonight's celebration to get the children involved, right? This is, to me, where the rubber hits the road in protecting our night skies. It's that ability to connect in awe and wonder as a child. I mean, how many of us remember just connecting with that night sky and just being so impactful? So Dea had an idea to run an art and poetry contest with the local students. And when I read these, when I saw these, literally for me, this is the heart of what tonight is about. So I'm gonna turn it over to Dea, and he'll kind of go through some of the winners and also some of the entrants. And do we have any volunteers to read? All righty. I'll let you take it away. Let's hear for Dea over here.
Did you want to try to show them? Okay, thank you. Yes, so having a poetry and art contest sounds like a really great idea until you start looking at them, and then the contest part of it, we're all like, whoa, how are we supposed to pick a winner here? They're all amazing. So we've got 16 kids submitted, some of them artwork, some of them poems, some both. And I had to recuse myself from the voting because my boy David turned in a painting, and Benjamin also had to recuse himself because his granddaughter Shoshana also turned in a painting and a poem. But when the committee took a look at all the work, it was decided that we're going to make sure everybody gets a prize. So we sort of reconfigured how we were going to do things. So all of these kids are going to get a $25 cash prize plus a sticker and a limited edition commemorative lapel pin for their lapels. What's a lapel? Okay, so the first one we're seeing here is from David Scheide, and this is called Stars Over the Mountains, or Milky Way Over the Mountains. And David is one of our runners up, so come on up here, David. Okay, one more time for David. Thanks, you guys. Okay. And what do we got next, Michael? This was acrylic on canvas. It's actually out there if you guys had a chance to look at it. This one actually lights up too. Can we get the next slide? Oh, this one is by Taya. And this one also has a haiku that goes with it. Is Taya here? Okay, this is Taya Tim. She's a seventh grader at the charter school. And this is I Gaze to the Night. So let's have a round of applause for Taya. We'll make sure she gets her prize. Okay, and the next slide. Okay, let's skip this one for the moment. We'll get back to this one. Okay, let's skip this one for the moment. We'll get back to that one too. Okay, this one is by Olivia Ushak. I think she's here, seventh grader. Come on down, Olivia. Congratulations. Thank you. All right. And this one didn't come with a title, but we were calling it the Sky Dragons. Amazing. It's watercolor. Yeah, next slide, please. Okay, this is Samantha Lemasters, and she's here. Come on down, Samantha. Another runner-up, $25 cash prize. Thank you. Okay, let's come back to that one. That's gonna be, sorry, we should have coordinated our, okay, so this is Naya Cabeza-Kinney. Come on down. The girl on the moon. Congratulations, Naya, thank you. Oh, this is Taya's haiku that goes with the painting. I gaze to the night, we are children of the stars, so free, so endless. Okay, and this one is from Kaya. I'm not sure how we say her last name. I think it's Hiljadik, Kaya Hiljadik. And she's not here this evening, but she is a fifth grader at Moffitt School. Let's give a round of applause for Kaya. Okay. Okay, so those are all of our runners up for the fourth through eighth grade entries. And we are going to now give out our first prize in the fourth through eighth grade category. Not the grand prize, but the first prize. And this is a $50 cash prize from the town of Crestone. As soon as we can bring that slide back up. Does someone want to poke their head out there and see if Claire is in the lobby? Let's bring Claire in. Come on over here, Claire. Claire is our first prize winner in the fourth through eighth grade category for her painting. We're going to bring it up here in a second, as soon as we can get the slide. Yeah. Go grab it. Okay, here we go. So you have to come and take a closer look at this when you get a chance, because it is an acrylic on canvas, and she also has integrated some crystals into the painting from a geode. Yeah, tell us about that.
Recently I had bought geodes at a library, oddly enough, and we smashed them, and I was like, and then the art project was a thing, and I was like, oh, I could use those as the stars. So then I did, and I just kind of I painted first, and then I just sprinkled them on. Woo!
Awesome. Thank you, Claire. Big round of applause for Claire Desain. Woo! Okay, so before we announce the grand prize winner, we're going to take a look at our high school entries. We didn't get any art entries from high school students, but we got a number of amazing poems. So, and unfortunately, their high school graduation of the Crestone Charter School is this same evening. So most of those kids, I don't think, have made it here. Although me, I might have seen one or two. Okay, so I'm gonna go ahead and read these poems out for them. So you want to just let me read them? And yeah, okay, I'm just gonna read them. Okay, our first poem is an untitled poem from Aspen Hollier. Is Aspen here? Ask her if she would like to read her poem. Or come and get her prize. Would you like to read your poem, Aspen? You don't need to use your microphone if you don't want to. Okay, let's give Aspen her prize, which is a $25 prize. And a big round of applause. I was lying in the grass, looking at the stars, gazing at the planets, thinking about Mars, hoping the sky would drown out the sound of cars, heal my pain, fade my scars, my mind rejecting my own thoughts. I did not want to think or cry. My mind was tired, as well as my eyes. That's all I wanted, to absorb the Milky Way. I would lay here until I start to decay, until I'm cold and my body turns gray. So I'll lie here until the night sky fades back to day. Okay. And okay. Is Milo here this evening? Okay. So Milo is actually our first prize winner. This is our $50 first prize in the high school category. And the Dark Sky Committee really, they just unanimously loved this poem. So this was chosen as our winner. The sorrowful moon is staring at me. I'm terrified by her ominous beauty. Do you think she ever feels lesser, thinking the sun will always be better? He'll always outshine her with his light blinding, trapped by a gravitational binding, conquered by Earth as a sign of power, stuck like a princess trapped in a tower, not even her own planet. She's someone's moon. Only been a month. New moon comes too soon. Already too dull, now seemingly gone. Werewolves and curses. She did nothing wrong. Sometimes I feel the very same way, constantly being outshined every day. And we'll make sure Milo gets the prize. Okay, next one. Okay, I don't believe Asher is here this evening. Asher is another runner-up, $25 prize. Stars up in the sky. Stars up in the sky like frozen raindrops way up high. Little suns shining bright, what a beautiful and nice delight, longing, waiting, standing still, looking, seeing up over the hill, now rising up with fright, it's almost time for first light, twisting, turning, curving, swerving, can you see the mountains burning, can you see it running fast, light is coming, coming at last, hidden by the sunburst sky, it's time for the stars to say goodbye. And this is by one of our graduating seniors. She just graduated about 3 hours ago, Hannah Sect. The absolute bliss you make me feel, laying down under your incredible galaxy, the sky I can't quite understand, the way your stars shine through, looking up at the magical night, I feel like me again. You bring me back to a time when I was young, looking at the same night sky, you've always been with me.
It's a
to sort these out. And Ayla Teeter, another graduate, fresh graduate today. Making stars come, sorry, connecting stars like in childhood, making connections in adulthood, finding the Aquarius constellation and wondering what connects, looking at friends, wondering how it affects. Stars connect us no matter where from one side of the galaxy to another. We know the terms, stars, suns, planets, moons, and asteroids, one language to fill the void, connecting and driving in one way of life and following through until the afterlife. And from Ava Guidry, made from the same star, I looked into his eyes, knowing only the stars are as beautiful as him. I looked into his eyes, wondering how someone could have been made so perfect. Someone made so perfect, I feel something different with him, the feeling of two souls that were made for each other, twin flames, soulmates, two people made from the same star. And Matai Karuna, also another senior graduate today, just graduated 3 hours ago. Laying in the cold grass, staring up at the sky, the moon shining bright, the stars, an ocean of sparkling lights, the shadow of the Milky Way barely seen, always present, but dimmed by the lights of man. With the ocean of stars comes a sea of thoughts. Are we alone? Is there anyone else out there? Is there something, somewhere, looking back at me? Will we ever know? How did all this even come about? What came before? Are we even capable of knowing? I can only hope we are. This one is from Genevieve Ushuk. She's actually here tonight, I think. We're going to give her her prize. I'll go ahead and read the poem. They say it's freezing, dead, and that we're alone. But how could that be true? When you look up, everything twinkles with life. It's like a city in the sky, ripples in the cosmos revealing stretched patterns of many, and in millions through billions of years to come, it will all be gone, and the sky will shift once more. Beautiful. Is Genevieve here tonight? Oh, she's not here. Okay. Okay, so now we're going to take a look at our grand prize winner. Now, the grand prize is pretty cool. We're going to give to our grand prize winner night vision binoculars. Okay, so let's take a look at this. Now, Shoshana turned in a beautiful poem and a painting to go with it. So maybe, let's put the painting up, and I think Shoshana is going to read her poem for us.
It was the down one.
That yeah. One, yes. Shoshana is a fourth grader. And her poem is called The Magic of the Night Sky.
Some trees like swaying side to side, others enjoying staying still with glory and pride. There is a whisper not many creatures can hear, and the whisper only comes here and there. The whisper comes from the trees and the stars, and they say, "You are our children, and you're not too far." The moon and the stars, they come and they go, but when you can see them, they have a magnificent glow. A glow unlike any other, a glow filled with life, magic, and wonder. Some nights they are covered in clouds and thunder. Now you see this light that has been brought. It can change your thoughts. So be grateful for what you see, for others do not encounter what there is to be. When I look up at the stars and the moon, it is as if I were listening to a beautiful tune. To imagine how beautiful it is to be a child of the stars we see. When I look up at a single star, I'm blighted from the world and end up far.
Shoshana Bielendorf.
Get your prize.
Oh my gosh, one more round of applause for all of our entrants.
Can you bring it down a little bit?
That was an incredible day. Thank you so much for conceiving of that. We say contest in quotation marks. You know how hard it is to share your art in front of a crowd? Oh my gosh, it is. I know a lot of you know the feeling. So it takes an incredible amount of courage to put yourself out there like that. So young people, you're my rock stars tonight. Thank you guys so much. Amazingly done. All righty. So we have this nice space cleared in front of us here for our next artist, our next performer. And I need to check if she's ready. Oh, she's right there. Do you have all your gear? All righty. Well, part of the transition that, or the kind of shift we had to make this evening to take it from the outside to the inside. And even if we had cloud cover up there, I was going to introduce our next performer as the brightest star in the sky tonight, because she is an aerialist. And I'm sure a lot of you have seen her perform around town. She's been doing such great work, and she has such passion for this craft that she's been learning for 7 years and perfecting. And one of the amazing things that stuck out to me about our next performer is that not only is she perfecting her own craft, but she's teaching it to others, and she has a passion for that. And so, ladies and gentlemen, our very own Milana, accompanied by her rhythm section over here. Come on out, gentlemen. And Dea was her middle school teacher as well.
Do you want to talk a little bit?
Yeah, let's do it. So when I do flow arts, it's kind of a very broad kind of dance interpreting emotions and feelings. And when I do that, I love to just kind of make that dance for Mother Earth and for the sky and for the earth, and just kind of have that as a gift. And a lot of other performers look at that possibly in that way as well, as it is a presentation, a gift, and it can be taken in by many energies and eyes and sights as well. So yes, and I'd just like to thank Dea and the drummers for accompanying me. And yeah, I'm just going to be doing some double hoops and fans for now, since we can't have the whole rig in here, but you guys will probably see me sooner or later, and or already have. So yeah, now that we're pretty much all set up, thank you so much.
And that's right, I forgot to mention, she was going to be way up in the sky tonight on her rig, but this is her grounded experience for us. Take it away, Milana. so amazing. Your very own Milana, everybody. Oh my gosh. Thank you so much, Milana. Alrighty, we are almost at our celestial presentation where Dr. Shane is gonna get up and take us on a tour of the night sky here. He's gonna blow your mind with some information on black holes, and I cannot wait to hear about that. As we get ready for one more little short performance, I'm gonna just do a little short thing here. We've talked a lot about art tonight. We've talked about the effect of the stars on us in our own soul and our own heart and how that connects us to our own creativity. And so what I wanna do is, I wanna invite my friend Patrick up over here. And if you remember last year, if you were at last year's event, his painting entitled Children of the Stars is our official artwork for Crestone Dark Skies, and this is it. So what I wanna do, as we display this amazing photography that Mr. Scott Stevens did with his equipment back here, we're gonna cycle through these images, and these are all taken here, ladies and gentlemen. These are all right in our own backyard. But as we do that, I'm gonna have Mr. Patrick Moore describe what is behind this painting and the story from as a child that he shared with me that impacted me a lot. As you do this, I'm gonna be setting up my stuff and I'm gonna join you with a little music, all right, as you tell your story. All righty? So, everybody, Patrick Moore.
Hi, everybody. You know, I just think it's awesome that a community spends so much time, energy, and devotion to preserving the dark skies, the dark sky. But of course, we're not just preserving the darkness of the sky, we're preserving the ability to see our celestial neighbors, our celestial family, and to have that connection. And my own personal connection started a long time ago, and it inspired this painting. This painting is called Singing with the Stars. When I was a little boy of 3 years old, my family lived in a dark place. It was Odessa, Texas. And my mother had this habit of taking me for a nighttime walk right before bed. And one time she was holding my hand, and we were walking, and I was three. And I stopped, and I heard this sound. I heard a resonance. And that resonance sounded very much like what James and Sarah Kate played for us tonight. And like a dream, I knew exactly what that sound was. And I knew that it was the stars singing to me, talking to me, resonating. And that's what this represents. And that's the little boy that felt that. And so so I stopped. And my mother was holding my hand, and she stopped with me. And I was transfixed by what was going on. And she just stopped and held me there for 5 minutes or 10 minutes. And then I looked at my mother, and I said, "Mommy, I can't wait to go back and sing with the stars." And she did the most incredible thing. She looked down at me and she said, "I know, son, I know." So that validated my connection to the stars and to all. And we saw tonight that connection is in all our young artists. Weren't they brilliant? They were so brilliant. But that type of expression and this type of expression and the poetry can only come when the connection is true and deep and heartfelt. And that's what we're preserving. And I just think it's awesome that a community values that so much and devotes so much to preserving that connection.
Story, Patrick, is so amazing. So to that end, with that story, I did this last year, but I haven't shared this song with anybody. But I wanted to do what Patrick was explaining, how that painting came to be on that walk in that cool Odessa night. Was it cool? Yeah. I'm filling in the details, right? That's what we do with good art. We look at it and then we fill in the details, right? Come take a walk with me, my son. It's almost time to lay your sweet head to rest. But before you do, let's walk in the cool. Let's let this night calm your fears. There's only so much I can do to point you in the right direction. Dear, if you only knew, my son, how much love surrounds you, from as near as his mother's heart to the farthest skies above. If you ever wonder who you are, why you came to be here, you feel you've traveled far. Redirect your eyes, look up at the skies. We are children of the stars. Oh, how they stop you in your tracks. You head up to the heavens, and I can only imagine what this beauty is bringing. I know it full well, my son, as you turn to me and say you cannot wait till the next time the stars are singing. So if you ever wonder who you are, the purpose of your place here, well, sometimes it gets hard. Just redirect your eyes, you look up at the sky. We are children of the stars. And the stars, they burn with their beauty. And the stars, they share this night sky. And we all have a duty to make it right. So come take my hand, my son. It's almost time to lay my head to rest. But before I do, let's walk in the cool. My time has passed, how you've grown. I thank God for the beauty, and I hope you know I'm gonna meet you there in the love that's as close as his mother's heart. So if you ever wonder who you are, like your problems are so important, you're stuck behind the bars, you redirect your eyes, look up at the sky. You will realize that we are children of the stars. We are children of the stars. Hey, and that's our That's our saying here in Crestone, right? We are children of the stars. Patrick, I wrote that about your story. And for the town of Crestone, for their dark sky gathering. Oh, yeah. All right, I got one more song for you before we bring Shane on up.
Yeah? Should I begin?
Anybody have a PowerBook charger? For a MacBook? That's not part of the song. Someone does? A power cable for a which one? Oh yeah, it's Lori out there. She might have one. Alrighty. So these stars of Crestone definitely called me to be here. I'm from California. And I try to come out here as much as humanly possible. But they called to me back in 1997 when I was sent on a 30-day silent retreat down at the old former Nada Hermitage on my way to being a Catholic priest, which I didn't make it all the way, became a musician instead. But something that opened myself up to the fact that I was an artist was being here, was being in Crestone. When I came here, I could not stop writing. I would sit on the roof of at the St. Therese Hermitage over at Nada, and the songs would just come. They would just come to me. And so over time, I changed my course, and this is what I've been doing, is writing music. Here's a song called Crestone. It's about my journey out here. Crazy. Those ideas in your head. Who you been talking to, listening to, that fills you with them. From the outside, looks like you got it all. Life and music, family, a little money, and a house on the hill. Some crazy dream keeps calling me back. Boy, you really wanna risk all of that. You see the signs point you down the road to some desert mountain home way down in Crestone. La da da da, down in Crestone. Da, 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 da. By the way, you guys want to help me out on this one? So when I say Crestone, you guys go like, da, 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 da. Okay, da, 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 da. You guys got that? It's pretty. Da, 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 da. Okay, keep that in your brain. Ready? Miners will mine. Always searching for that golden vein. After they find it, they mine it, and then they hock it, go look for more of the same. Conventional wisdom will tell you just stay put. But you wanna keep walking in the dark caves, my brother, can you see your own foot right out there in front of you? You see these dreams, leave me alone. I wonder if it's something you lack. You see the signs point you down the road. Take a plunge into the unknown, down in Crestone. Crestone. You sound good, let's sit in Crestone. You guys are good, you catch on fast. Brother, if you've seen them, all these stars in that pristine desert sky. Apart from the noise, traffic, confusion of this city light,
dance.
Yeah, I'm well aware this could be a midlife crisis for me, but I don't want no girlfriend, no Porsche, no Audi. Just wanna buy me my desert monastery. You see, these dreams won't leave me alone. I keep on asking if I'm the one, or the signs keep pointing down the road to take a plunge into the unknown, down in Crestone, da 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 da, down in Crestone, da 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 da, down in Crestone, da da da, down in Crestone, da.
Alrighty, and now, ladies and gents, thank you so much. I'll record that song one of these days. All right, Professor Shane Burns, are we ready? Did we find a power source? All right, we're going to use our imaginations. That is right. Let me get you a microphone, my friend. By the way, thank you so much for making the drive today and braving the snow through the pass. Is it raining out there yet?
Sort of? Can you hear me now? Can you hear me now? Well, thank you for inviting me. I'm Shane Burns. I'm a professor of physics at Colorado College. And I had this plan for tonight. One of my plans for tonight, the first plan for tonight, was we have a small portable telescope, has a nice little CCD camera in it. And I was planning on pointing it to different objects and projecting the images so everybody could see it. Well, that plan, of course, didn't happen because there's been many, many, many nights that I've spent under cloudy skies. In fact, while I was at the University of Wyoming, I used to have colleagues planning ski trips around when I was going to observe because they knew it was going to snow. So that plan didn't work out. My alternative plan is there was some news last week that maybe you heard about. There was an image of a black hole at the center of our galaxy that was published. And I thought I'd talk about that and talk a little bit about gravitational lensing and that sort of thing. Well, that has lots of nice, pretty pictures, but unfortunately, they're locked into my computer, which is now dead. So instead, I'm making this up as I go along. And so I thought what I'd do is I'd start by telling you a story about how I got interested in the universe. It's kind of a long story. Not the long story in my life, not a long story. I won't keep you here for all that long. And then I thought I'd maybe mention a few things about the black hole, even though I can't show you any images. And then I'll take questions, and I'd be happy to answer any questions you have about just about anything astronomical. So first of all, I am only here because of an experience I had looking up at a dark sky. I grew up in Wyoming. Some of you maybe heard this story before, but that's okay. I grew up in Wyoming, and my family used to do a lot of camping. So we'd go out, and my father would fish and so on. One night we went out. It was about midnight. We camped in a tent, and I had to get up and go to the bathroom. So I went over to the, I couldn't find a flashlight, which would have been my natural inclination. Did you find it? Oh, no. You did. Oh, this is my wife, Stormy. She saved me many times. Okay. Okay, maybe we can get something going. And at least I can show you some pictures. USB. USB. It's got an HDMI.
It actually does have HDMI? Okay.
It does.
That's great.
All right, are you seeing something? Yay! Okay. All right. Well, I'll finish the story. Maybe this is the most interesting part of tonight's talk, actually. I got out of the tent, and I didn't have a flashlight. And as I opened the tent flap, I could see the sagebrush. I was out in a big sagebrush flat, not unlike kind of this. It was more sagebrush than cactus, though. But I could see these kind of ghostly shadows of the sagebrush. And I thought, that's odd. Is there somebody camped by us? And no, it was a moonless night. And I looked up and I saw the Milky Way. Was directly overhead, and I was just astounded. I looked up, and for the first time in my life, these questions popped into my head. What is that all about? How did that happen? Where did it come from? Where did I come from? What's my place in it? And I had taken high school or junior high science courses, and I knew what stars were. I'd been told, you know, there are big thermonuclear explosions. I knew all of that, so I knew something about it, I guess, but I was just filled with this sense of awe and wonder at the universe. I didn't go out and become an astronomer the next day. In fact, I wandered off in college. It took me 6 years to get my bachelor's degree, because first I wanted to be a philosopher, and then I wanted to be a psychologist, and I finally ended up with physics because my wife took an astronomy course and ended up studying the stars. But what that experience did for me was give me a sense of wanting to know about the world, a sense of intellectual curiosity. I wanted to know about that world. And so I pursued trying to know about the world. So that's my experience. And I think Lots of people have had that experience. So my talk was actually going to open up with telling you a little bit about the dark skies. You know that the skies here are dark. That dot is Colorado Springs, and of course, north of Colorado Springs is Denver. This is an image of the U.S. at night, and we're actually in a very lucky location down here. Maybe that's Alamosa, I don't know. But in any case, we're in a very dark part of the U.S. But it's becoming less dark all the time, and there are lots of reasons why you should be concerned about dark skies. Loss of dark skies harms wildlife, wastes money and energy. There's negative impacts on mental health. But I think the most important reason is it deprives us of inspiration. It's that inspiration that I had when I was a kid that kind of inspired me to want to know about the world. This is an image of the Milky Way, actually taken down just south of here, near the sand dunes. And this is the kind of thing that I saw that night. Maybe not quite as extravagant because, you know, this is a pretty good camera and a long time exposure, but you've all seen the night sky. It's pretty impressive, especially the Milky Way. Here's an image taken of the same region of the sky the night before in Colorado Springs from the observatory deck. So that gives you an indication of what you can see. You can see there's Jupiter, this is Jupiter, I think that's Saturn. Taken exactly the same part of time and one day apart as I came down here. And we try to teach astronomy from that observatory deck. It kind of robs you. It does make the constellations a little easier to point out, because if there are too many stars, constellations get confusing, right? Well, we can't look at the night sky tonight. That's my plug for dark skies. This is also my plug. Anybody know what this image is?
Satellites.
Starlink. Yeah, Starlink. So Elon Musk has a very laudable goal, which is to connect the entire world, get everybody, no matter where you are, access to internet. That's great, but it depends upon a constellation of satellites. And this is an image taken from the National Undergraduate Research Observatory, where I teach a course in observational astronomy for some of our CC students. And this is what those satellites do, as they streak across the sky, completely ruin possibility of imaging. Question? Kessler syndrome?
Yeah, with the current decaying orbits and everything going on around and stuff we have up there.
The good news is that most of these are gone now because their orbits have disappeared. But I'm not familiar with it, sorry.
Oh, just like hypervelocity objects traveling around one collides with another, it sets off another cascade.
Oh, yeah. That's a serious issue, and if you work for the U.S. Air Force, one of the things you do is track space junk and try to make sure that it's not going to hit your satellite, your precious satellite. And they've tracked things like that for years and years, you know, things like one of the gloves that one of the Gemini astronauts lost. They actually tracked that for years and years and years until its orbit decayed. Those are serious issues as well. Another issue is, I don't want to get sidetracked. But anyway, this is another example of losing our night skies, losing our kind of precious night skies. And so it isn't just the city lights that we need to worry about. We need to worry about this as well. Currently, there's no regulation of this kind of thing at all. So Elon Musk could launch, I don't mean to give him a bad time, but could launch something like that again, and it could be devastating. But let's go on to something more interesting. Okay, so this was the image that was released of the black hole at the center of our galaxy. Now, what we're seeing, of course, is not the black hole. What do black holes look like? I'm having a hard time connecting. Maybe it's because they look like that, right? They're black. They're called black holes for a reason. Light can't escape from a black hole. So what are we actually seeing? We're actually seeing the material around the black hole. Boy, this is, I'll just punch the buttons. That works better. So we're actually, we only actually see a black hole by the effect of the material around it. This is actually an image of a black hole. It's a simulated image. It isn't a real image. It's a simulated image showing what it would look like if a black hole was placed in front of that wonderful Milky Way image we saw, and we were hovering some 600 kilometers above it. Now, I was inspired originally by going out and looking at the night sky, but the thing that inspires me now is knowing about these things. There's kind of a paradox in knowing about these things, knowing about all things astronomical, all things physical. I'm a physicist fundamentally. And that is that the more you know, the more you realize you don't know. But also, the more you know, the more fantastical and weird the universe turns out to be. And black holes are a good example of that. So this is an image of what it would look like if you were hovering 600 kilometers above a black hole. This black hole, this is a simulation, of course, and this black hole would be about 10 times the mass of the sun, which you might say is a lot, but it's not. That's typically what we think most stellar-sized black holes, how they're created. They're created at about 10 solar masses because they're produced by a collapsing of a big star. If I hovered above this black hole, I would have to, of course, hover above the black hole, and I'd have to turn on some rocket engine so I didn't fall into the black hole. If I did that, I would have to cause my spacecraft to accelerate at 400 million times Earth's gravity. Okay? That means you would be flat. You know, you're not gonna be able to do that. But is there any way we could see something like this? Yeah, we just go in orbit. Because if we go in orbit around it, we're in free fall around it, and we wouldn't have any issue with that. So let's say we're in free fall around it, and we drop a little probe into it. I'm gonna have a couple of graphs, maybe a little math, but don't worry, there's no test. Okay, but I want to illustrate how knowing a little about this just makes you understand how fantastical and awesome the universe is. So what this is a graph of the position as a function of time of some probe that I drop into this spacecraft. Drop into this black hole. Now, what we expect to happen, of course, is that it would fall in and it would start going faster and faster, and then finally it would fall into the middle of the black hole, and actually 15 milliseconds later, if you were riding on the probe as it fell in, you'd be in the very center of the black hole and squashed at the singularity in the middle. What happens there? We don't know. Is it, you know, it depends on quantum mechanics. But what about if I was watching it as I dropped this probe in? From my point of view, time runs at a different rate than it runs on that probe. It literally runs at a different rate. It runs at a different rate here in Crestone than it does at the top of Kit Carson Peak. Yeah, it really does. It's not by very much, but it's measurable. Some students and I a few years ago actually measured it from Colorado Springs to the top of Pikes Peak. It's a measurable quantity. Gravity changes time. And in fact, if we drop this probe in, what it would do from our point of view is it'd come down here and about 15 milliseconds later, it would come to a screeching halt. And it would hover there forever. So US scientists called these things black holes, Western scientists. At the same time Western scientists were working on black hole theory, there were Soviet scientists, this was during the period of the Soviet Union, Soviet scientists working on black holes, they didn't communicate very much. They called them, in Russian, frozen stars. Because really, what it looks like is everything comes to a screeching halt at the surface of that star. Why is it black? Because it also takes that light and shifts it out of our visible spectrum into the radio part of the spectrum. Okay, I know this is a lot of science, it's kind of weird, but believe it or not, that's the way the world works. Okay, it's been confirmed. So black holes are weird. Not only that, but it turns out that the forces closer to a massive object are stronger than further from a massive object. If I was above this black hole, my feet would be being pulled into the black hole at a greater acceleration than my head. By about 20 million times the acceleration due to gravity here on Earth. I would be pulled apart. I would have about the same force squishing me together because the gravitational force is radial and it pushes in as well. Black hole theorists call this spaghettification. I wish that had been something a little bit more creative, but if you took a chunk of steel and put it above the black hole, it would be stretched into a thin wire as it fell in. It's bizarre. That's the way the world works. Okay, so I don't want to take up too much time here, but I do want to show this little video. This is an animation of what it would look like if we did that experiment where we got in a spacecraft and orbited the star, orbited the black hole. Well, of course, as we looked at the black hole and we orbited the black hole, we would see different stars in the background, right? Well, let's see what happens. Incidentally, we'd have to be orbiting at about 2/10 the speed of light to do this. That star there is that star there. That star there is that star there. And if you look really closely, there's another one in there. These images end up getting doubled. How in the world does that work? Why is the world that way? I have no idea why the world is that way. Who built it that way? Have no idea. Maybe it was built that way for our amusement. I don't know, but it's pretty bizarre. It's stranger than any science fiction you can imagine, right? Why does that happen? It's because gravity bends light. So here's a prediction of general relativity that was done back in 1915. If I have a star here, this is the actual position of the star. The star's a light ray from the star will come and be bent by the sun and end up here on Earth. So I should be able to see this star, and it would appear over here. I should be able to see this shift during a solar eclipse. I can't see it in the daytime, of course, or when I'm looking at the sun, unless there's a solar eclipse, because the solar eclipse blocks out, the moon blocks out the sun's light, so I can see those background stars. This was a prediction that Einstein made. This fellow went off and measured it in 1919, and it's really what made Einstein famous. This made all of the papers. They measured this effect, and yes, it happens. This bending of light by massive objects. I always say, this is what made Einstein famous. Here's one of the images from that expedition. It's a nice solar prominence up here, and these are the stars that he measured very carefully their position and found out they got bent a little bit. A very tedious, involved thing to do, right? The details of working this out get pretty boring, but what you find is that things are really kind of amazing. This is another example of the same effect, except now we've got this big ring is a distant galaxy behind this galaxy. And the light from this distant galaxy is getting bent by the mass of this foreground galaxy. Pretty amazing. How do we get those multiple images that I showed you before? Well, we get those multiple images because gravity can around a black hole can extremely bend light. So here's one ray of light coming from this distant galaxy. It goes around and it gets bent so that we see it here. But another ray from this galaxy would go, makes an orbit of the black hole and ends up in your eye. Okay, it gives two images. And you see it over here. It can do it, it can go around two times, three times, four times, five times, and go down around many, 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 many times. And each one of those creates a successive image. They get closer and closer together and they get harder to see as they get squished together. But that's kind of amazing. That's why we get that bizarre image that we got. Astronomers use this to do things like measure the mass of the universe. So part of the mass of the universe is dark matter. What is it? Don't know. Why is it there? Well, we know it's there because we can do things like look at this gravitational lensing and from that infer how much mass is in this cluster of galaxies from the these arcs, this imaging of background galaxies. And so you can get an image like this, which is actually a simulated image of where all of the dark matter should be in that galaxy. Okay, back to the black hole in the center of our galaxy. So this black hole is a supermassive black hole. What are we seeing here? Well, we're not really seeing any background objects imaged. What we're seeing is this black hole has material that's orbiting around the black hole. And as it falls towards the black hole, gravitational energy gets converted into heat and it forms a big, hot, what's called an accretion disk. A big hot disk. If a star came in to this region, it would be ripped apart by those tidal forces that I told you about and become part of this accretion disk and gradually spiral down into the black hole. As it spirals around, it gets really, really hot, and that's what we're seeing. This is actually an image taken in the radio part of the spectrum by it's called the Event Horizon Telescope. It's actually an array of radio telescopes scattered throughout the world. And all of the radio astronomers in that consortium came together to make this measurement. From these measurements and from other measurements, you can estimate the mass of this black hole. It turns out to have a mass of about 3.6 million times the mass of the sun. How did that form? Nobody knows. You tell me, and we'll go to Stockholm again. Okay? You can see the center of our galaxy in the radio part of the spectrum, and there is this very bright central region. This is kind of fun to watch. We'll just watch it for a second. These are stars orbiting this black hole, which is right there. You can't see the black hole, of course, but you can see the stars orbiting around the black hole, and from those stars' orbits, you can infer what the mass is of that black hole. I'm going to ask one of our CC students, Katie, back there, to calculate that later on tonight. So. Okay. She just took a course with me, and she knows all the physics to do that. Okay. And that's how we know that it has 3.6 million solar masses. This is another galaxy. This is a galaxy called M87. It's in the middle of Virgo Cluster. It's kind of the big gorilla in the middle of the Virgo Cluster. It has this jet of material coming out of it. If you look closely at that jet, it's pretty spectacular. You can actually see these blobs of material being jetted out of the center. The mechanism for this is complicated, but it's powered fundamentally by a supermassive black hole in the center. This supermassive black hole has also been imaged. So this is an image of that supermassive black hole, again with the Event Horizon Telescope, a radio image, and this is the accretion disk around that black hole. Its mass is about 7 billion solar masses. Pretty soon your mind boggles and you start talking like Carl Sagan, billions and billions. How many of you remember Carl Sagan, right? Okay, everybody that's a little older remembers Carl Sagan. He always was saying billions and billions, but you kind of have to, all right? There's no way around it. Okay, so the universe is pretty amazing, fantastical, and I think the more you know about the universe, the more fantastical it ends up being, the more awesome and beautiful, really, that the universe is. I've always loved this quote from Einstein: the most beautiful thing we can experience is the mysterious, is the source of all true art and science. We saw some of the art inspired by that earlier tonight. Okay, that's all I have for you. Do you have any questions? There's a question over here. Okay, and then I'll... So our solar system is moving through space because it's orbiting the center of our galaxy, and our galaxy and the center of our galaxy has a black hole that turns out not to be a significant amount of the mass that's causing the Earth or the solar system to orbit. That if you start to take a look at galaxies that are nearby, you find that all galaxies are moving, and they're moving away from us. And in fact, you double the distance that they are away, and you double the speed at which they're moving away. That was the discovery of Hubble in the 20s, and that was the beginning of the so-called Big Bang model of the universe. It's that motion that is really due to expansion of space. Space is not solid, and it's not like a stage that, you know, is kind of the way we think about it. That's the way Newton thought about it. No, space, it's flexible, and it's expanding. Our discovery in we actually made the discovery in about 2000, was that this expansion rate is increasing at an increasing rate. It's accelerating. It would be as startling as throwing a ball up in the air. Instead of having it fall back down, it keeps going and in fact accelerates away. Nobody expected that. And that's why it was worthy of the Nobel Prize. Oh, God. Yeah, so the James Webb Space Telescope, I thought about maybe talking about James Webb Space Telescope, but then this image of the black hole was released. The James Webb Space Telescope will be amazing. It's sitting out at a point beyond the moon. Turns out, I was a little skeptical and a little afraid that things would not work, because it involved this telescope being, all the mirrors being folded up, launched to a point way out of reach. We can't send astronauts there to fix it. And then it all had to unfold, and it all worked flawlessly. It's about to send back images. There's all kinds of things you can learn. One of the big areas of research is extraterrestrial solar systems and looking for exoplanets. And not only looking for exoplanets, but figuring out what the atmosphere of planets around other stars is like. And that would give us a clue as to whether we're alone. Trying to sort out, that's one of the things we can get out of that. Another thing we can get out of that is some cosmology, trying to understand this accelerated expansion a little bit better. There's kind of a puzzle going on right now in cosmology. It's clear that there's something we don't quite understand having to do with the expansion rate far away being different than the expansion rate nearby. Why is that? James Webb Space Telescope should help us answer those questions. But like I said, there's always a paradox. The more questions you answer, the more you find out there is to know. So there was a question over here, and then there.
So with the animation that you have with the crosshairs, with the black hole, and then the orbit of the star, why did that orbit, as it got closer to the black hole, and it seemed like when one went over the black hole, there wasn't the
spaghetti? They didn't get spaghettified because they're not quite getting close enough, okay? They are getting very close, and in fact, if you look, it never goes into that place. The cross indicated this center that's been found by looking at radio emission, and you find that it never does go through there. It's orbiting. It's kind of like it's in a highly eccentric orbit, so it's orbiting kind of like a comet orbits around our solar system. Seems to zip in faster, further, and then zip out a long ways. But it never gets quite close enough to be pulled apart. You had a question?
Yeah, I have a question about solar system. And recent,
I don't. That's not my area of expertise there, so I'm not very knowledgeable about solar system objects. Sorry, I can't answer that. Sure. We're grasping at straws. So there's a couple of different things going on. This is to try to understand dark matter, and confusingly enough, something different called dark energy. So dark matter we know exists because because of those gravitational lensing images, and actually there's lots of gravitational effects that you can measure. So you know there's some bit mass there. The problem is it's dark. We can't see it. We also know it's not the kind of stuff that we're made of, meaning protons, neutrons, electrons, carbon atoms, things like that. So there's lots of hypotheses as to what that is, and they're getting wilder and wilder all the time because we just don't understand it. Dark energy is something that causes accelerated expansion. We're even more clueless about what that is. Okay, yeah, so the Large Hadron Collider, so one of the things that's being researched at the Large Hadron Collider, which is near Geneva, is the very early universe. And to understand the very early universe, you need to push particles close together at very high energies. And if you do that, there is the possibility of producing a mini black hole. Okay, that's the idea. There was actually a lawsuit that was filed to try to stop the construction of the Large Hadron Collider because one of these mini black holes could perhaps suck up the Earth, okay? Well, there's a couple of things there. One is that first, black holes don't necessarily start sucking things up. The gravitational force is proportional to how big the mass is, and the masses are so tiny that it isn't going to be very significant. If our sun turned into a black hole tomorrow and turned and kept the same mass, we would continue to orbit around the sun happily. We wouldn't suddenly be sucked in. Okay. The other thing is these mini black holes are probably produced in the upper atmosphere all the time because particles that are produced in supernova explosions bombard the upper atmosphere of the Earth all the time at higher energies than CERN can ever hope to get to. So if it happened, it would have already happened long ago. The lawsuit was dismissed in the end, and CERN was and the Large Hadron Collider was built, and we haven't been sucked into a black hole yet. So, but yeah, I mean, these are things that you have to worry about. You could ask, you know, the Manhattan Project scientists, you know, was that a good idea? Okay, one more question, and then I'll take questions privately if you want to ask me questions, but. Someone, oh.
So, like in that simulation, essentially, shouldn't the matter or the stars or whatever be getting stretched out, but they're remaining in stuff?
Those stars are way, way, way far away from the black hole. So, maybe I didn't explain that well. Only when stars get very close to the black hole would they get spaghettified and pulled apart. And then they're just way in the background and the light's being bent. Right.
From our perspective.
Right.
So then let's see. So you're saying matter then forever orbits the black hole and eventually disappears?
Yes, forever. From our point of view, so this is the weird thing about time. If we're measuring time on our clocks, we never see anything cross into the black hole. Everything is on the surface kind of the black hole. But if you jumped in, there's no hope for you. You're going to go in and you would be done within. No, you would be in a finite period of time on your wristwatch, you would be at the center. Yeah, it's weird. It's not paradoxical, believe it or not. Oh no, it's a sphere. Right, right.
The stars are going around it from all angles, obviously. So different things are rotating into it from different angles.
Yeah, so the black hole looks like a disk because we're just orbiting it. But I'm happy to answer questions individually if you have other questions. Sure. Thanks. Sorry about the technical difficulties. Thank you, Stormy. Thank you.
Thanks, Professor Shane. Nicely done.
Oh, thank you.
Thank you so much. One more round of applause, everybody, for everybody tonight who contributed. Thank you so much for being here, hanging out late with us, for rolling with the punches, and Lori for shooting some shots over there. By the way, 5280 Magazine has one of Lori Nagel's pictures in it from last year. Big publication, and there's a copy out there. And that's it. That's a wrap, everybody. Our second annual Crestone Dark Sky Gathering. Come on. Hang out with us tomorrow at the Cloud Station at 4 o'clock. Let's listen to some music together. Cheers, y'all.